I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, PMC, and let us exalt his name together, for the Lord is good. Now I said the Lord is good and greatly to be praised. Oh, taste and see. Has anyone tasted? That the Lord is good. Blessed are they that put their trust in him. So the psalmist says, praise ye the Lord. Praise God in this sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Let everything that hath breath. That means if you're inhaling and exhaling, let everything that hath breath praise ye the Lord. Put your hands together and bless the name of our God today. Oh yes, oh yes. He is awesome and worthy to be praised. It's my privilege to be with you here at Andrews University here at Pioneer Memorial Church. I bless God for this opportunity, my brothers and sisters, to worship the Lord with you. We've had an awesome experience in God today. Amen, church? And indeed, his spirit is here. We want to thank our illustrious president of this university, the administration. We thank all those on the Black History Planning Committee and Deborah and all those who have made it possible for me to be here. I thank you for this opportunity. To the great pastor of this church, Pastor Dwight Nelson, who is one of our great preachers and pulpiteers, we respect him greatly, and we thank you for sharing this pulpit with us today. God indeed has a word to say to us. I got to give a shout out to my best friend, my girlfriend, and my wife, Stephanie, and the kids who are watching in Atlanta. We praise God for you. And we want to let you know that my wife always tells me, never say, I'm going to be short. She says, because that's when you preach the longest. So I'm going to say, I'm going to endeavor to be timely. I believe in this new beatitude, blessed are the brief, for they shall be invited back. So we'll try to do our very best. We will endeavor to do our very best. Every preacher who's here knows that sometimes you make up your mind to preach a certain message, but then you have to give way to the Holy Spirit, who edits sometimes at the last minute. So what's printed in your bulletin is a sermon entitled Break Every Chain, and the Spirit told me to preach that last night, which is what we did. This morning he's moved me in another direction, and so I'm going to be obedient to the Spirit this morning. Is that all right? I was going to do it anyway, but I just said that. I want us to turn to 2 Kings chapter 7. And I'm going to ask you to do something just so I can feel 100% comfortable and at home to preach with freedom. I'm just going to pretend like I'm back home in Atlanta at Mount Olive Seventh-day Adventist Church with my folks. I'm going to ask you to do what we do. Would you do this for me? Would you stand to your feet for the reading of the word? Would you just stand, please? We have you stand for two reasons. I think it's nice. I think it's good to honor the word of God by standing. We stand when we sing the national anthem. It's good to stand reading the word. But not only that, you've been sitting for a long time. Some of you might be tempted to go to sleep. So we want you to be awake for the word of God. 2 Kings chapter 7, verses 3. And I'm going to just read down to verse 8. I'm going to be preaching today from the New King James Version. You can read along silently in whatever version you have. And it says this, now there were four leprous men at the entrance of the gate, and they said one to another, why are we sitting here until we die? If we say we will enter the city, the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit here, we die also. Now therefore come, let us surrender to the army of the Syrians. If they keep us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall only die. And they rose at twilight to go to the camp of the Syrians. And when they had come to the outskirts of the Syrian camp, to their surprise, no one was there. For the Lord had caused the army of the Syrians to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses, the noise of a great army. So they said one to another, "Look, the king of Israel has hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to attack us." Therefore they arose and fled at twilight and left the camp intact, their tents, their horses, and their donkeys, and they fled for their lives. Verse 8, and when these lepers came to the outskirts of the camp, they went into one tent, ate and drank, carried from it silver and gold and clothing, and went and hid them. Then they came back and entered another tent and carried some from there also and went and hid it. I want to preach from the subject this morning, I dare you to move. I dare you to move. Let's pray. Now, Father, in this sacred moment, we confess, if we ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need you now. So use this frail and fragile vessel. Put your words in my mouth. And Father, we pray that you will comfort the disturbed and disturb the comfortable. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I want to tell you a true story of four men sitting outside the gate. The city is behind them because the city is besieged by the Syrian army. And these four men are sitting outside of the gate. They have not volunteered to be marginalized. They did not ask to be ostracized. But the society in the city saw that there was a problem with them. They looked at their skin and saw the open wounds, the ulcers, the cankers, the thinned out skin, and they realized they had leprosy and put these men outside of the city. They put these men outside of the city, outside of access to any health care, outside of access to their families, their loved ones, their social network. They were totally disenfranchised outside of the city, these four men. These four men are in a sad state because the society that has put them out here has not only deemed them unsafe and unhealthy, but has also deemed them unworthy to live amongst them. They were afraid. Their disease, leprosy, was indeed contagious, and no one wanted to get that, so they put them outside. They marginalized, ostracized, and put them out there. Not only did they do that, they dehumanized them and devalued them. Because the value that they placed on these four men was contingent upon their health and what they looked like and what they could contribute. But I want to let you know that no matter what condition we may be in, for we do not have a skin problem like they did, but we do have a sin problem. And whenever people look at the sins and the things in your life, they may deem you not valuable, not worthy, but God looks past the obvious that other people see, and he sees the value in you. See, it's not your mistakes that define you. It's not your past mistakes that confine you. You are valuable because of who made you, not because of what you've been through, not because of the degrees behind your name, not because of your resume. You are valuable because of who created you. They devalued these four men because they did not deem them value. But how many of you know society cannot define your value, only your your creator, you're looking at me like you don't understand. So save me a seat. I'm going to sit right down beside you. Let me talk a little bit closer to you. I remember when I went to the Chicago Auto Show years ago when I was here at the seminary. I went with Dr. Charles Joseph and some of our cohorts from the seminary. We hung out on a Saturday night at the auto show. And as we were there, we were looking at the different cars. I went by the Porsche display, and I liked that. I went by the Mercedes-Benz and saw the new models. But then I meandered over to the Bentley display. Ooh, that was a sweet car. I remember it. It was silver with peach leather interior. I mean, a serious car. When I looked at the price tag, on the price tag, it said, I think it was somewhere between $200,000 or $250,000. So I walk up to the guy because I'm curious. I said, well, why does this car cost so much money? Why is it so valuable? I said, the Mercedes-Benz S-Class was $90,000. Why is this $200,000? And he said in his fake British accent, I could tell he was American, but he was putting on a fake British accent. He says, well, sir, you must understand that there are three things that make this car so valuable. I said, well, what are they? He said, well, number one, you must understand that these cars are not made on an assembly line. They are made by hand. He said, number two, you've got to understand that we only make a few every year, so these are exclusive and unique. He said, and number three, you see that peach leather interior? I said, yeah. He said, you like that? I said, yeah. He said, well, here's what it is. You must understand that this is no regular leather, but there are lambs raised on a special hill in Finland. And we feed them special food, and then we slay them to be able to make the interior of the Bentley. I said, you know what? That sounds like how I was made. Because you and I were not put together on evolution's assembly line, but we were put together by the almighty hand of Jehovah. You and I are unique. There is nobody like you. There is nobody who has your personality and your idiosyncrasies. You are a unique make. And there is a hill, not in Finland, but in Calvary, where the lamb was slain to decorate your insides. You are valuable because of who made you. I wish I'd get somebody to bless the Lord right there. That it matters not what you've come through and who you are. These people in society marginalized, ostracized, and they were prejudiced against these four men. They looked at their skin and judged them unworthy. Sound familiar? They're outside the gate. They're outside the gate, and as they're there, they start this conversation. They start this wonderful conversation. They say, why sit we here till we die? They said, if we go back into the city, can you see them? They're sitting at the gate. Their backs are to the city gate. The city is behind them. And they say, if we go back to the city, there's famine there. We'll die there because everybody is fighting over the little bit of food in the city. So if we go back to the city, we'll die a dramatic death. They say we cannot go back. And may I suggest to you that their analysis of their situation is true. For not only could they go back, you and I can't go back. We can't go back. I hear some people talk in a nostalgic and romantic way about the good old days. There are people who always say, we need to go back to the good old days. But I have to ask you, how far do you want to go back? And what do you define as the good old days? I mean, do you want to go back to the good old days of platform shoes and bell bottoms and afros and picks? Do you want to go back to that? Do you want to go back to the bebop days? Do you want to go back to, how far do you want to go back? Do you want to go back to the days of the 80s where crack was infiltrating the hoods mysteriously pumped in to the system? Do you want to go back? Do you want to go back even further to the 60s where you and I might not be able to worship like this together? How far do you want to go back? Ah, do you want to go back to the days where you and I had to drink from different water fountains and go to different bathrooms? How far do you want to go back? Do you want to go back to the days where even, not in our cities and not just in our governments, but even at our general conference, the cafeteria was segregated? Do you want to go back? How far do you want to go back? Do we want to go back to the days where strange fruit hung from southern trees? Do we want to go back where the backs of African slaves were opened up while the master told him he was lazy for not picking enough cotton? How far do we want to go back? May I suggest to you that we don't need to go back. We don't need to go back, because if we go back and revisit American history, Black history and American history are not separate. They are intricately linked and intertwined and cannot be separated. You and I, our destinies are inextricably linked and tied together. And I say we cannot go back. But not only socially, think about your life. Do you really want to go back? Do you want to go back to the place where you have wrestled in sin? Do you want to go back before Christ found you? I know you look real dressed up and nice today. You really do, and you look real religious and spiritual. But if you could take your halos that are over your head and just put them beside you on the pews and just be real for a moment, that all of us have a past we're not proud of. I wish I had a witness here, that all of us have some things that we want to go past. And I ask you, do you really want to go back? Do you want to go back to alcohol-stained breath? Do you want to go back to the places you went and the things that you did? Do you want to go back to the abuse of your past when they said they loved you but they harmed you? Do you want to go back out of what God snatched you out of? I suspect you don't want to go back. Because here's the thing, if we slide back into our past, there's no guarantee we'll make it back from our past. And I wonder if there's somebody here who wants to just stop right here and thank God that you're not what you used to be, and by God's grace, you'll never be what you used to be. Someone here has been tempted to go back because your present situation is not perfect, but you've got to understand where God brought you from. I mean, if you just think about where He found you, what you were doing when He found you, who you were with when He found you, how long you had been there when He found you, somebody here would begin to bless the name of the Lord, because if it had not been for the Lord on your side, I know you got doctrine, I understand. I know you understand prophecy. But none of that saved you when you were deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. It was the grace of God that came and got you where you are. Oh, yes. You can't go back, because there's no guarantee you'll make it back. These lepers' analysis is keen. They say we can't go back to the city because the famine can't feed us. The famine will allow us to die right there. And so they say we can't go back. But then I like what they say, if we stay here, we will also die. Listen to me this morning, and you can tweet this. There is something dangerous about being delivered from your past, because the subtle danger is, if you're not careful, you can mistake the present for your destiny. You missed that. Yeah. Understand this, that the subtle danger of being delivered from your past is that you can get a religious and spiritual arrogance and confuse your present state with your destiny. But what I like about these four lepers is they realize, even though they can't go back, they know they can't stay where they are. I'm coming for you this morning. See, because the issue that we have is that many of us are way too comfortable with where we are right now. You got some education. You're smart now. Yeah, you got some truth. Ooh, you give some people some truth and they lose their minds. Yeah, you got some present truth. So now you know everything. And so some of us are too smart to be converted. Because we studied so much that we think we know the minutiae of God's will for our lives. These four are at least humble enough to understand that though their present situation is better than their past situation, it does not mean it is God's destination for their lives. I'll say amen all by myself. Amen. Now, understand this. Hang out here with me homiletically for a moment, because their analysis is something that we should do. Any organization and any nation that is beyond self-critique and evaluation will be doomed to repeat the past mistakes. So shall we evaluate our present situation? Why are we sitting here until we die? As a church and as a nation, if we're honest, yes, we've come a long way, but we are not where we should be. For the leprosy, we have some leprosy on our skin. We have something that's eating us from the inside out. The leprosy of ageism is in the church. This is why you heard at the last general conference session in Atlanta that what is happening is that there are many of our churches in North America that are literally dying, because there is a whole generation of young people and young adults that are leaving in droves. There are some churches that don't even have children's ministry anymore because there are no children present to minister to. So most churches don't even have AYS anymore because the young people have seen it and deemed it irrelevant. And here's the problem. Leprosy eats away slowly but surely from the inside to the outside, so that what you see, by the time you see the manifestation on the outside, the damage internally is worse than what you see. And in our church, there is ageism. How many of our church boards and conference constituency boards and executive committees have young people represented there? We keep saying they're the church of tomorrow, but they're really the church of today. And it looks like like America and corporate America and that Silicon Valley values our young people more than we do. The ageism is eating away at us. But not only that, sexism is eating away at us. Why is it in this great, great nation of ours that women who are educated the same way, they have and contribute the same skills and gift set, they know everything and they are able to be on par with their male counterparts, are still paid a less wage than their male counterparts? Sexism in this country, and yes, even in the church. How is it that the majority of our churches are filled with women, but the majority of the leadership positions are filled by males? Let me come a little bit closer. This is not a new phenomenon. Do you not know they were doing this in Jesus' time? Come here, Jesus, and testify. Do you remember when the woman was caught in adultery? Interesting, it says the woman was caught in adultery. Doesn't it take two people to commit adultery? Yet the woman is caught in adultery. They drag the woman out the front door. They let the man escape through the back door. And we do the same thing in church, where we have historically dragged unwed, pregnant teenage girls into business meetings and disfellowship them while homeboy gets away scot-free. Sexism. And then there's racism. It is the unspeakable. It's the unspeakable that we never talk about. We never talk about it because it disturbs all of us. And to a certain extent, it should. But not to the point that we never talk about it. Because you can never conquer what you never confess. The leprosy of racism eating away from the inside out on both sides in every culture, because racism is not a white problem and it's not a black problem. It is a human problem. And we all, in some form, in some fashion, carry our bias, our prejudice, and we bring it even to worship. We don't like the R word. The R word to us is as comfortable as the F word. Because for some cultures, it makes them immediately defensive. For others, it makes them immediately angry. But I ask you the question, how will we ever really have true unity if we never let the Holy Spirit bring us together through honest conversation? How, God, will we ever really move past being polite to each other? How will we move past simply being politically correct? How will we move past this if we don't realize and do like the four lepers and say, why sit we here till we die? The truth of that matter is, most of you students, you hang around with each other now. You've got Asian friends, black friends, white friends. That's a good thing because you're on this utopian campus of Andrews University. But the truth of the matter is, let's be honest, that when we leave here, most of us will retreat to our subcultures where we will have little to no interaction with each other. Mm-hmm. I said it. Mm-hmm. I remember when I was living in Huntsville, Alabama, went to Oakwood University. I did not even know there was a predominantly white church in Huntsville. All I knew were all the black churches. Because here's the thing, the problem with racism is that not everybody is racist or hates another culture. A lot of times it's simply that we are indifferent. If you can't say amen, just say ouch. It's all right. No, I mean, all of us. I mean, most of the time, it's not that we hate another culture. It's not that we despise them. It's just we're just not thinking about them. But is that what Christ wants for his church? You know what I notice about these four lepers? The great denominator of humanity is tragedy. These four, we don't know what subcultures of Samaria they came from. We don't know the pigmentation of their skin. But I could just imagine one leper was probably from South Side Samaria, from the hood. And another leper was from the affluent neighborhood in North Samaria. Another one was educated and had a college degree. The other one simply had a GED. But guess what? They were all in the same place because they all had the same problem. And despite your ethnicity, your culture, what food you eat, what accents you have, we all have the same problem. We need a savior. We need salvation. So they say, why sit we here till we die? Because here is the true analysis for our church and for our country and even for our personal lives, that for many of us, we are too comfortable where we are. Because you read your Bible, because you come to church every now and then, you check off your spiritual list. But do you not know you are not saved by your checklist? Even the Ten Commandments, for many of you, you might say, well, if I try real hard, I can master them. If I try real hard, and maybe some of you have gotten there. God bless you. I hope I can be like you one day. But please understand that Jesus comes along and he messes your whole plan up, because then he elevates human morality from the Decalogue, and he says, the Decalogue says not to commit adultery, but I say unto you, don't even look at a woman with lust. See, the Ten Commandments is the basic requirements for following Jesus. It's not the highest. Jesus says the highest is, you know you're going to perfection when you love your enemies like I do. Why sit we here till we die? So I like these four men because they do a proper analysis of their situation. But you can get the paralysis of analysis. It's not enough to simply say what's wrong. You've got to know what to do. So for the next couple of minutes, let me share with you what they did. The first thing, if we're going to move on and be what God has called us to be, not settling for our present situation as our future destination, is that you have to be humble enough to realize that God has more in store. We have to be honest about our condition. We have to be honest about where we are. We have to be honest about the fact that most of our personal prayers are rote memory prayers and that we're not really praying with much passion. We got to be honest about the fact that though we espouse faith in Jesus, most of the time when tough times come, we give up our faith. We got to be honest about the fact that we might be in the church, but Christ is struggling to get in us. We've got to be honest about the fact. Are there any honest people here who will say, I know I'm not what I should be, and I've got to grow in grace today? You see, you will not grow unless you're honest about your present condition. But not only that, number two, you've got to be uncomfortable with your present condition. Help me to preach this, Holy Ghost. Here's our problem, that most of us are concerned about stuff, but we're not dissatisfied with it. See, the problem with the church, even this great church, with this great last day message, is that we're concerned about racism, so we'll make up a committee at GC to talk about it, but we're not dissatisfied with it enough to actually do something about it. See, there is such thing as holy dissatisfaction. When you no longer can live with your present situation, Jesus comes into the temple and he sees them selling and turns the sanctuary into a marketplace. And we have misused this text to teach that he was talking about temple reverence because maybe the bleating of the sheep was too loud and the cooing of the turtle doves was too dismissive and too disruptive. But that's not what Jesus was doing. He was angry because they were exploiting the poor in the temple. They were exploiting the oppressed, and he got physically upset and overturned tables. What am I saying is, when's the last time you got upset about the present situation of your church and of your spiritual life? Because I suspect if you're never moved to get so dissatisfied with where you are that you'll never do anything about it. So you'll show up at church, you'll have and do your little religious routine, you'll assuage your guilty conscience, and you'll go back to living your own life Monday through Friday so that you are a Seventh-day Christian. You've got to become uncomfortable. Church, we have got to, hear me from the bottom of my heart, we have got to become uncomfortable with the present racial state of our church. Amen. Uncomfortable, dissatisfied. We can no longer be this way. We've got to become uncomfortable with where we are, because it's only then we will seek the Lord and we will fall on our faces, and all of us, every one of us, ask for forgiveness for our prejudice, for our bias, for simply tolerating people instead of loving people. That's where the change happens. So what do they do? What do they do? I'm glad you asked. What do they do? They're tired of their situation. They said, here's the thing. If we go forward, the Syrian army may kill us, but there's a chance that if we go forward together, notice that, together, that if we go forward together from different parts of Samaria, but together, maybe different dialects and parts of the region, but together, different past experiences, but together, if we go forward together, there's a chance we can live. Because you will only go forward to seize the future if you are so sick of the present that you're willing to risk the unknown. They get up and they say, let's go. They start walking at twilight towards the Syrian camp because they realize that playing it safe is risky. That staying where you are is risky. That feeling good about your present situation spiritually is risky. Because there are people who go to church every Sabbath who will be lost because they have not been converted. They've been informed but not transformed. So they said, we can't sit here. Twilight, they start walking towards the camp. And in their minds, the whole time, they're saying, they may kill us, but they might not. They may kill us, but they might not. Sounds like faith. I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm going to trust him. I don't understand his will, but I'm going to go forward. I don't understand what he's calling me to, but I know if he called me, he must know what he's doing. Because here's the thing about my God, thank you, Jesus, is that he never asks you to go someplace he's not already been. That if he asks you to go someplace, he's already gone before you and prepared the table. See, here's the thing about this, is when they get to the Syrian camp, nobody's there because God has made the enemies hear a sound of an army. He made their enemies lose their minds. They thought that an army was coming, so they left everything because my God is so good that he'll make your enemies make you dinner. They show up because the Bible says that he sets the table before me in the presence. But in this case, it was in the absence of the enemies that when they get there, watch this, God had already been there. And I suspect if you move forward, you will find that what you fear isn't real, that what you're afraid of will not be there. Because if God be for us, who, can I preach it, will be against us? They walk in and the food is there. They haven't eaten for days, but God will make your enemies make you a meal. They're eating the food that they don't deserve. They're taking silver and gold that they don't deserve, because the good news of the gospel is if you go forward in Jesus, God will give you more than you ever thought you would ever have. Do I have a witness? They begin to feast on what God has done, because though you don't know the future, God knows. I'll end with this. Otis Moss, pastor, was telling the story of how he was watching this movie with his parents. He was watching this movie. It was a dramatic plot. It was one of those thrillers, you know, when you don't know how it's going to end. And so he and his mother are sitting there, and they're biting their nails. They're holding each other, because in the middle of the movie, the hero and the heroine look like they're going to die. And so they're looking and they're watching, and with trepidation, they're looking at it. But the father is over in the door frame, and he's leaning very confidently and he's smiling, and the son is looking at the father like, what does he know that we don't know? Well, at the end of the movie, everything works out and the hero and the heroine make it, and then he goes up to his dad and he says, Dad, how did you know that everything was going to be all right? Did you see the movie? And he said, no, son, I didn't see the movie. This is the first time I've seen the movie. He said, but I did read the book, and because I read the book, I knew how the story was going to end. Well, I don't know what scene in your life movie you are in, but I can tell you I read the book. And the book says that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. I don't know your movie, but I read the book. And the book says that they that have come out of great tribulation, washed their robes white in the blood of the Lamb, shall stand on the sea of glass. Black people and white people and red people and yellow people, hand in hand. I don't know your story, but I read the book that God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. So I dare you to move. I dare you to move from where you are. I dare you to be dissatisfied. a holy dissatisfaction with your present situation. I dare us to move from tolerance to authentic love. I dare us to move from simply just having United Youth Congress when we preach to each other, and maybe we should have a United Racial Congress where we come together and pray for forgiveness on either side so we can be reconciled. I dare you to move. I dare you to move from simply just having an appreciation of another culture to inclusion of other cultures. I dare you to move. I dare you to move from praying rote little prayers like, now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep, to falling on your face and learning how to pray and cry out to God. I dare you to move from being polite to being Christ-like. I dare you. Because if you do move, God will provide for you what you could never provide for yourself. I end with this question. What are you waiting on God to do that God is waiting on you to do? I dare you to move. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. As the music plays softly, here is the word of God to you and to me. These four men represent all of us, for we all have the same problem. We all are sitting outside the gate of the great city, and we will enter in together. We must enter in together, or we will not enter in. For Jesus says, how can you say you love me? He says, how can you say you love the Father whom you've never seen? Yet you can't love the brother you see and go to school with and the sister you go to worship with every Sabbath. The measure of our Christianity is not how well we sing hymns and not how well we quote Ellen White. The measure of our Christianity is how much we love each other. Whether we like it or not, we have to go in together. If you're here and it's your desire to not stay where you are spiritually, relationally, socially, I just want you to stand so I can pray for you. Would you take the hand of the person beside you, your brother, your sister? Take the hand of the person beside you. You are holding the hand of a miracle. And today, the people on either side of you, whether you know them or not, are your brother, your sister. The people in front of you and behind you are your brother and sister. We're all lepers, in need of healing and salvation, which we find in Jesus Christ. Because Jesus went ahead of you to Calvary while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us and secured your future. But we have to get it together. I want to pray for us today. And if you are not where you need to be with God, you are one decision away from being on your journey to your destiny. Let's pray. Now, God, we confess that even in this message, many of us were disturbed, a little uncomfortable, because you said some things to us that we didn't really want to face, but we had to face them anyway. You showed us who we are. You held up the mirror, and we see who we are. But we thank you, Jesus, that you don't do it for condemnation, shame, or guilt. But you do it for conviction, so that we can decide to let you lead us into a glorious future, both personally and corporately. God, this is your church. There is absolutely no doubt about it. But God, we are not all that you've called us to be. We confess. Now we ask that you do a renovation of our hearts, every one of us. May we confess, forgive, and forsake so that we can walk into the kingdom like we are right now, hand in hand. And we will find that there is a welcome table there, and we shall sit and eat at the table of brotherhood and sisterhood. In the name of Jesus, so let it be. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. God bless you.